just realize one of the most important things you can do when you have a contaminated site is collecting fungi on site. Right. How many of you have ever picked wild mushrooms before? You know how to take a spore print? Okay, that's what that paper's for. When you do find a fungus or a mushroom, you can clone this with the tissue like we're doing here. I do it on a Petri plate. But you can also take a spore print because that's where all the genetics are in the spores, right? You get a almost the same parent strain or a different ecotype. Ecotypes are what you need to understand that makes remediation much better. Is we're all humans in this room, all right? But we're all different. Meaning an oyster mushroom from that side of the fence is different from the one on this side of the fence. They have different talents and different skill sets. They all have different keys. So we're going to be working with oyster mushrooms a lot today because they have a lot of chemical keys. When you look at the interior where you chop the mushroom open, that's mycelium, compressed mycelium. So all you would really need is a tiny, tiny piece of that. Literally, like, not even that much. I'll do that so you can see it. That's generous in a lab. You need a tiny, tiny piece. And this one can start a whole other colony. You stick this on the plate, and then it radiates out. Now you have copied that fungus. You copied that exact ecotype. That would be important if you find one growing out of a contaminated site, wouldn't it? But then you can take a spore print and streak it and then get an even better strain. Or you can put the contaminant inside the media. Mushrooms create heat, carbon dioxide, and they sweat. That is important, all right? The first one is the most important, because you're creating biomass, it's producing heat. Mushrooms can overheat too, just like you can. So there's a thermal death limit above 105, 108 for a couple hours can kill a fungus. So when it's colonizing, it's producing heat. That's really important. So when we do an installation, right, it's producing heat. When you're growing oyster mushrooms in a greenhouse, it's producing heat. It'll generally add about 15 degrees more heat to room temperature. So if it's 80 in here, what would the inside of one of these bags be? 95. So if it's 100 degrees out, what would it be? See? You can kill it. So you have to be aware of the thermogenesis factor when you're producing a mother pile like we were talking about.
We're going to try and create a mother pile. Yeah.
So are we going to pile it up big during the summer? No. You're going to want to keep it thin, all right, and flat, maybe a foot or two deep. You have to monitor that. In the winter, you can do the pile. It'll help incubate it in the other opposite sense. So that can work in your favor. So be careful with the big mother pile. You get a big anaerobic cooked core. You'll kill all of it. So this is what my ceiling looks like under the scanning electron microscope. You've got this network, okay? The network is important. It's self-healing. It interconnects itself. It also becomes a micron filter. This is very important with bacterial remediation. So we're going to cover that with that filter over here. So it becomes a network. And bacteria, this is a physical entrapment. It's a physical phenomenon. All right. These filaments also are sweating natural antibiotics. So not only are they going to trap bacteria out of the water that you've passed through this, but they're also going to stun and kill and potentially feed on the bacteria. You know, E. coli could be 50% protein by weight. It's a food source for fungi. So they can trap, stun, and kill them and use that as protein. So we rated mushrooms according to their tensile strength, and nobody else really was looking at that with remediation for years. That's really important. And that really is site dependent. If you think about it, the site you're going to see later is fairly flat. Is tensile strength that important? No, probably not. But what about a site with a slope? And rate of growth. Right, so you've got to have a fungus that grows really fast, great to solidify, it's tensile rating, is it good with bacteria, is it good with chemicals, and you just score them. Okay, I just scored these. And now I can use this chart for any situation we want.
interesting fungi in here.
Lentinus tigrinus scored one of the highest, right? That's this one here. That's a relative of the shiitake, okay? I don't know that until I play with it in the lab. I culture it out on a Petri plate, and after 3 or 4 days, I take my scalpel and I have to cut it to transfer it. And when I try to cut it, the scalpel starts going squeak, 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 squeak. And I have to saw through it. Saw through it with a surgical brand new scalpel. It's like plastic. Right, so that can be very useful in gluing wood chips together for a mycelial filter. All right. There's other fungi that are very weak and you would not do that. Or there's fungi that, like a maitake, has really good tensile rating, but it takes way too long. You can't spray that on a hill because it's going to blow out when you have a rain event like this. You need something to gel it together quick. Mushrooms create heat, carbon dioxide, and what else do they create?
Sweat.
They create sweat. So what is in the sweat is the magic. That's why all mushrooms are magic, right? They sweat these chemical keys, and this can be on demand. That's what's magical about these fungi is they get a whiff, those infantry cells, get a whiff of what's out there. If they're starving, if they're hungry, they get desperate. They'll turn on some silent genes. They'll activate them, turn them off, turn some off, turn some on. And think of fungi like a factory, like an assembly line. They're tooled to make certain things, whatever they need, whatever those keys they need. Antibiotics, fungals, things that eat herbicides, things that eat PCBs, right? When they run out of food, they start sweating and getting desperate. And then these are non-specific enzymes, which are capable of combusting and breaking down very recalcitrant compounds, right? I showed you guys these last night, the fungi attacking another one. So in the lab, you can look at some of these papers and it says, well, it'll degrade DDT 80% over a period of 10 months. Then what? Right? That's important to know, but it's not to the finish line. Okay, so what happens is these fungi, when they attack these other molds, they're looking for partners. All right, it's creating an antifungal compound and sweating it out. Sure, that's important, but how do we get it to the finish line? So we need to recruit bacteria second. So this is an epoxy kit, part one and part two. We have mushrooms as the first responders, and then we need to understand that we need the fungi to recruit bacteria from the site in order to hand off the baton to the bacteria second. That's species sequencing, okay? There's also vermicomposting is very useful with remediation, especially micro-remediation, which you'll see, because worms are extremely attracted to the fungus. Right. And they're a little bioreactor. They use their gut bacteria to break down the contaminant even more. All right. But it has to get the fungus first. There is many different forms of remediation. And I want to make it clear that micro-remediation falls under bioremediation. There's bioremediation is complete. There's also biotransformation, which can be even more dangerous than what you started with. So keep that in the front of your brain, not in the back. That when you're testing something and there's biotransformation, you go back and you say, well, it's gone, the fungus got rid of it. Maybe it didn't get rid of it first, right? You need to test and see what's in that soil, because it could have transformed into something even more toxic to fish or more toxic to humans, okay? What we're looking for is complete bioremediation, and that occurs with species sequencing. That's what your goal is. All right, so inside these metabolites, this is very useful for spill sites, right? If you are parked your car, empty lot, or spill a little bit of oil, industrial sites like that, we looked at that last night, that unit is filters out, it's a biological filter. It'll filter out bacteria, almost all of it within 12 hours. Drinkable, all right? chemical pollutants, it needs contact time. So you might have to run that if there was, if I put atrazine in there, an herbicide, it might take 2 or 3 weeks. Okay, but you can also use a unit like that as an enzyme harvester, washing mycelium. It's sweating when it's running out of food and we're just rinsing. It really wants to get rid of that metabolite. It's somewhat toxic to itself. It's swimming through its own waste. That's why it wants the bacteria. So we are rinsing it, and now we can capture in the bottom bin, we'll do later. It's an enzyme harvesting unit. You don't need the mushroom anymore. It's in the fluid. That's pretty damn useful, right? You can make a very large enzyme harvesting unit and just harvest and wash the mycelium, collect the enzymes, and go out and percolate this on a contaminated site. Right. So when you do have a site, this I did this for a PCB spill up at in the upstate South Carolina. Testing the soil, figure out how many, what the depth of the wood chips might be. I said to use the maximum, maybe 2 feet. It's a lot of wood chips. And it really depends on how deep the soil is. These enzymes are aerobic. All right. So at a certain point, you don't want to saturate the site with too much water because you're losing the ability to respire. Okay. So we're going to cap it with wood chips. And then we're going to water the wood chips, and we're going to let that mycelium eat the wood chips. It's preferred food source. All right. What happens when they run out of food or habitat? They start to produce the metabolites. All right. It's starting to sweat. What do we do to a mushroom when it sweats? Give it a shower. All right. We're going to rinse it so the enzymes percolate down into the soil. All right. You need to put that on a timer. And those are aerobic, the combustion, it's a combustion process. That's why they create heat. So if you think of it like they're igniting and combusting these molecules, PCBs, hydrocarbons, what you have is that molecular degradation that's also working in concert with the bacteria that are in the soil already, remember? So that's a huge plus. And once you have that decontaminated soil, you go back, you retest, and now another beautiful byproduct is that cap that you've made. Topsoil. They make beautiful topsoil, and also with the addition of worms, they're in there, and then you've got this. And I encourage that you would partner with a native plant expert, right? And planting community, a plant community, not a monoculture back in those sites. And we were down at the site, we're thinking those aquatic plants, and we started thinking about mycorrhizae, and mycorrhizing these back into the site. And if there's plants on a contaminated site, digging some of those up, staining the roots, I'm looking at the mycorrhizae that are there, that are tolerating those conditions, but they're also remediating fungi. So you can harvest those roots, chop them up, and put them back into the nursery. In the soil, with your new plantings, they will pick up the mycelium by root fragment, and now you have inoculated plants with a fungus that was tolerating those site conditions. So here it is, this fungus is running out of food, it's like getting a whiff of the environment, it needs a food source. It's not big enough to produce a mushroom. So what does it do? It shifts gears, it rotates, you know, those chemical keys, it activates the silent genes to produce a cocktail of enzymes that's capable of eating this. But this was the demonstration where it's 3 times the labeled rate of the bottle, all right? Because homeowners don't follow the directions. So I was trying to see what part per million this fungus can tolerate. And so far, I really haven't found a limit because it keeps eating it. So you can make it stronger and stronger. All right, so this is day 10, it kind of paused, and then after 2, I thought that was it, the limit, and at day 12, it just took off. Now, there's no food source in that auger, that gel. There's no malt. I wasn't nice to these guys, or girls. All right, I put them on the plate, and I starved them to death, and they ate it. Okay. And I also did this with motor oil. So that's how we can make these little traps, too. You can make plates with specific media. All right, you can put contaminants in the gel. Now I could give those to you, and you could go to a site, sprinkle a little bit of soil on there, shake it up, put it inside and watch it, see what shows up. You can go down to the beach. All right, you can scoop some of the soil out of the beach, find a salt tolerant fungus. All right, the There's all kinds of ways you can do that. So these are like little traps. These are traps, I use these for training, but you also use these for traps of different parts per million and billion. So I could put salt auger in here. What was the salinity of that water, Willis? Was it 20 per thousand? Like 0.2% or something like that. So I think fungi, the oyster mushrooms, would tolerate that. So we can do different percentages of salinity here and put fungi on there and see what they're capable of tolerating. Whenever I do a remediation project now, I take soil samples because I want to build biomass first, like in that filter, and then I'll take a soil sample from the site and I'll mix it in with the water, all right? And then it'll go through that filter. The fungus will select the bacteria that it wants. Its team, remember, it's recruiting those to take that. It really wants to clean that up to the finish line. Alright, so I take my psyllium, I float it on contaminated water, and I figure out where, you can take this, just snip this and plate it out, and I can figure out what bacteria it is. If you really want to know, right? You can dilute that, you can isolate the bacteria, send it to the lab, and now you have an identity of the players. There's only one problem. Less than 2% of all bacteria can be cultured in the lab on its own. So when you do a dilution and you start streaking things out, are you getting the real picture? You're losing 98% of everything that's there. It cannot grow in a lab. We don't know yet how to grow. So if you streak it on a plate, you're not getting a real representation. Microfiltration of water, we're going to make these biological filters. So there's a couple different ways to do it. All right. This is a recirculating unit. If you wanted to test water, it cleans water in batches. It's like a batch reactor. Okay. So this particular one is recirculated. This is just broken out. It's kind of exploded. We have a pump, comes back through a biomass, gravity fed, and now here's your reservoir. So now you can put anything you want in this reservoir. You can put parts per million of an atrazine, right? You can put colony forming units of bacteria, specific CFUs per mil in here, and then you're going to turn it on, and then you can take a sample here out of the bottom shelf. You can also hybridize it, so then we're looking at maybe a fungal biomass here, maybe plant biomass here, maybe some floating plants. Okay, we're looking out of the dock. Maybe we want these with some mycorrhizae. All right, there's mycorrhizae on aquatic plants too. The plants help them out with that oxygen. They transport oxygen down to the roots, so they're not starving or asphyxiated. So these have holes. You all see the holes in them?
Yeah.
In the bottom. So that one has holes. The second one has holes. That's a duplicate. All right. The only difference is this one has what I call a spreader plate on top. Okay. That distributes the water nice and evenly rather than just a single hose coming out. That's essential. All right. So you put these in here. All right. This is a mixture of sand and mycelium.
It's a half-half mix, right?
It's a half-half mix, yeah, so it's 50-50. So this is what you can start with, and then you can scale it either way. We were talking about that last night. Well, how much do you know? How much sand do you know, and how much to use? Well, you have to run the filter. You have to figure it out. You want rate of flow. You want this to flow. If you put all mycelium in here, it forms a cake. It becomes hydrophobic, and the water won't flow through it. All right, so you want to break it up a little bit. The sand is non-nutritive. So it builds a matrix of cells around it. So it makes a network, a loose network. So this is a wonderful, wonderful filter. If this was, we would just let this gelling, I call it gelling, but it would knit itself back together into a little mass in about a couple days. So you can put this in here, let it sit for about a week, and it's ready to run. Right? This is a biological filter, right? Preferably composed of your native debris. Why? Because that's what your native mushrooms want to eat, okay? So try to find those strains, match them up to the debris you're using for the filter. You're going to fill it, and you're going to let it colonize before running the unit. It's pointless if you don't. You're going to make sure it's clean and wiped out of all these chemicals before you use it again. Once the media is colonized, the bottom can be filled with whatever you want to put in it, all right? And you would definitely get... need to know the concentration of what you put in here, not just going to dump it in. And, you know, mushrooms fruit out of these. The question is, are they edible? That's the big question, isn't it? Right. With chemical pesticides, these have shown no residual pesticides in the fruiting bodies. Okay. The media has been biotransformed, hasn't it? So you got to be very careful with the media. It needs more time to break down. Metals are different. So metals may be hyperaccumulating depending on the species. Right? King Schafferia doesn't hyperaccumulate metal that much. Morels, a lot. Puffballs, a lot. I don't eat puffballs at all in the city. And they're tempting, let me tell you. Do you get the puffballs up here?
Yeah.
And down in my area, they're a little bit smaller. They're about the size of a football, like this big. But they always grow along roads and out right near parking lots, you know, like they need it. They need that contamination for some reason. There's a reason they're hyperaccumulating that stuff. You know anything about that? So beware of what's fruiting. Now, if this was an herbicide, all right, what you're going to do is you can pull that out. And this is called making a dilution to extinction. So if you know what the contaminant is, if I had atrazine and I made this up, all right, you do a beam test on it. Or you take a sample, take 90% and you switch it, put it in 10% and put it in the next vial. You shake that up, put 10% in the next vial with water, next percent. So then you get a spectrum, all right? I do this in jars. I take all this stuff and I water beans with it. That would be part per million, right? That would be part per million. You see, eventually there's nothing in it. It's diluted to extinction. So all you have to do is really water your beans with this, water your beans with that, water your beans with this. Do 3 or 5 seeds per treatment, and you will see death, death, injured, less injured, less injured, less injured, and fine. Okay. If you have that as a spectrum, you have that as a reference, as a guide. Because you could send all this off to get tested, but it would be really expensive. Right? So just as a field test, you can do that, where you water your bean test. Especially with the persistent herbicides, it'll kill stuff quick. And that would give you the amount of time that you need based on the sampling rate that you took. You take it every day for a month, maybe at day 14, it was over here somewhere. Right? It did the reduction that you needed. So that's the dilution of extinction, and then you use it, you can water in or soak seeds like in these sunflowers. You can soak them in the dilution, and if they germinate, it's below the acceptable level. So working with the contaminants, just make sure that you are, you can do the dilutions, all right? Do the sampling, do controls. A lot of this, like the reason we can do it install is because we already know that that particular fungus eats a certain thing. You know, hydrocarbons, let's say. Right. But for this sake, for water filtration, you really need to know the amount of biomass you need. What if I use 90% sand? That's 50%, and I got the same results. What did it do to my project? It made it cheaper. Cost is everything here. It really is. Somebody says, how much is it going to cost? You think they're going to ask that? Damn right. What's more expensive, mycelium or sand? You know, herbicides are quick. Herbicides are actually very fast. Hydrocarbons, a little bit longer. PCBs, a lot longer. You can understand that they keep biotransforming into something else until it's carbon dioxide and water. That's your end goal. Okay? Carbon dioxide and water from something that complex. And we don't need mushrooms to fruit with remediation. All right? The only reason we may want them to fruit is for a heavy metal removal. Metals is one of the most difficult things we're going to have to try to talk about. All right. Some fungi are capable of making it less bioavailable. All right. That's maybe the best we can do. Okay. There's a membrane approach where you can put a cap on that soil, have it pull out the metals, but then you have to remove the cap. Right, and maybe compost that. And what you're actually doing is, if we can remove a contaminant and not move it, that's our goal. A lot of companies just move it. You know, they have a license just to bury it somewhere. I think being a little bit more creative, like the companies in New Zealand and China, you know, they're figuring out how to mine this stuff and reclaim it. Right, like gold and silver, you know, reusing it back into circuitry. mushrooms are really good miners. They're excellent miners.